basics of living for God. And so we appreciate it. Thank God. I'd ask Brother Michael to share something about prayer tonight. He's going to kind of lead this off. And, he knew he was going to have to do this tonight. And of all nights, he had to work over. And so he had to struggle to get here. But I'm sure that's going to make it even better. So, Brother Michael, God bless you. Just come on. And we've got this set up for you down here. So I'll make it easy for you.
Brother Smith asked me to say something about prayer, and every time I get up here to talk, it seems like it's really hard, so excuse me if I mess up or don't say something right. But prayer, you know, if you just look at it, it's just simply, you know, it's talking to God. But, you know, it's more than that, because it's your spirit talking to his spirit. And it, you know, it can become very emotional, and it should be, you know, because he's our creator. Amen. He's the one that breathed the breath of life into us, and I just want to be able to talk to him and get in his presence. But what I feel like he gave me for this is that, you know, we learn that the soul and the word are two things that are eternal. But what he gave me was prayer may not be eternal, but it affects eternal things.
Amen.
You know, it does, and it can affect your witness to other people because of, you know, how your prayer it affects you and how you act and things like that. It affects your attitudes. It even affects, you know, it can affect your facial expressions, how people see you. How you react to them and everything. I remember I working for this guy. He was actually my boss's boss in a fab shop over in Buna. And I could see him come in the shop every once in a while. And, you know, he would have a aggravated look on his face or act like he was mad for, you know, quite a while, it seemed like. And then I seen him come through the shop one day. This is a Pentecostal man. And he just had such a pleasant look on his face. And I said, well, you look good today. You know, you seem like you've maybe been aggravated or something here recently. He said, yeah, but I had a good talk with the good Lord, and that made all the difference.
Amen.
And, but a prayer affects what you say, can affect how you treat people. You know, you've heard the term Pentecostal or Pentecrossed. Yeah. I don't want to be like that.
Amen.
I want my prayer life to be, you know, in such a way, in a manner that it affects me. It changes me and makes me more like God, makes what I have appealing to other people.
Amen.
You know, I don't want to be, you know, a Pentecost person. You know, we all have seen them people, you know, and maybe even know some of them. But I remember working with this man one time, and he was Pentecostal, but every time he went to say something, he had this little term he put in front of it. And it's not something that most people even in the world would want to say. And, you know, it makes you think, what's his prayer life like?
Amen.
What would cause him to say something like that would affect his witness to other people? And, you know, and we really have to watch these things because we are a representation of the church.
Right.
And, you know, in your prayer life, I remember when we went to a men's conference a few years back, and there was this one preacher there. I believe he was a Mexican. At least he was bilingual Spanish. And, you know, he told a story about whenever he was checking into this motel and he got to his room, and this prostitute actually came into his room. And he said the only thing that kept him from doing wrong was his prayer life. His prayer life kept him from doing wrong. And, you know, it's so important, your prayer life. But prayer, it affects where you go. But more importantly, it's going to affect where you don't go.
Amen.
Where, you know, what What kind of internet sites are you going on when nobody's looking, nobody's around? You know, but God can see it. And your prayer life is going to affect that. You know, what about, you know, other places in the world? Should we go there or shouldn't we go there? Your prayer life can guide you.
Amen.
And affect you in that manner. And I remember here the last year or so when I was going to a church in Pennsylvania when I was off working. If you have ever wonder, well, should I do this? Shouldn't I do that? If you're not sure, just think, would it offend your pastor? Would it offend your pastor? Do you think he would approve of that? And that could be a guide that you can use. You know, sometimes we can say, well, would Jesus do this? No, but Jesus, and some people, you know, is far off and away. But if you use somebody that is that you respect and that you love like your pastor. But your prayer life is going to affect your salvation, whether you're hot or cold or lukewarm.
Amen.
And I want to make heaven. I want to make heaven my home. And you're going to have a prayer life to make it.
Amen.
And I guess I come up here to encourage somebody to pray, to catch the vision Brother Smith is trying to give this church. And it's just going to take prayer to be close to God and to be saved. If you're not praying, you're not, you know, what's the old saying? You have to pray to stay.
Amen.
If you don't pray, you're not going to stay in the church. And if you do stay in the church, you may end up being one of the lukewarm or cold people.
Come on.
And you know, that's the Lord said he's going to spew you out of his mouth. And I don't want to be like that.
Thank God.
But Leonard Ravenhill, he wrote in Why Revival Tarries, we cannot have big results from small prayers. The law of prayer is the law of harvest. Sow sparingly in prayer and reap sparingly. Sow bountifully in prayer and reap bountifully. The trouble is we are trying to get from our efforts what we never put into them. And I would just encourage somebody, come to the prayer meetings, come pray before church. And, you know, prayer begets prayer. Once you start praying, if you keep praying, it's going to encourage you to pray more, especially if you're really getting in the Spirit and can really feel what's going on.
Yes,
thank you.
Thank God. Thank God. That was very powerful. I appreciate that. And this is just us talking to us. Thank God. This is one of you. Thank God. Brother Michael sits on the same pew as you do. He goes out in the same world you go in. He struggles with the same thing you struggle with. And these are secrets, and these are things that have helped, you know, his walk with God. And I know it can help my walk with God. And so thank God for it. I appreciate prayer. Thank God. And you know, with prayer is the word. Thank God. So we've asked Brother Dale to share some things about the word of God and the value of the word of God. I'm telling you, I hope you fall in love with the word of God. I am so thankful there's 48 people that brought these Bibles or so to help them get through, and all of you that are doing it on your own in some other way, because the word is powerful. Thank God.
Praise the Lord, everybody. The sign up there, Rhiannon took it down, but that's all right. I told her to put something else up there, so she's doing what I want. But it said God talks, and that's what we're talking about. And tonight, I hope I can convey to you a message that God does talk.
Amen.
He talks to us. I'm not sure that was the intent of naming these little sessions God talks. But God does talk. And he talks to us in many ways. In 1 Corinthians 12:28, it tells us that he talks to us through, first of all, apostles, and then through preachers, and then through teachers and evangelists. In Ephesians 3:3, Paul said that he talks to us via revelation. He gives us revelations. Acts 2:17, it says that God talks to us through visions and through dreams. And I'm not into this modern-day dream theology. One of our nearby neighboring churches here a few years back, they had classes on how to interpret your dreams. Every dream had a meaning. Dreams is part of our natural process of life, folks. Every dream doesn't have a meaning other than your brain is what they call it, defragging, I guess, in the computer. It's moving all the data around so that it can process it right. But God does talk to us through dreams. And God talks to us especially through the inspired Word of God. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. And so God does talk to us through the inspired Word. And, you know, we do the bread program every year. We try to encourage people to read the Scripture. And you need to read the Scripture. And you need to, in addition to reading the Scripture, you need to study the Scripture. And in addition to studying the Scripture, you need to use a verse Brother Smith used the other day in his sermon. You need to take the words, you need to find them, you need to eat them, and you need to let them be the joy and the rejoicing in your heart. The psalmist in 119, he said, thy words have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. So you need to digest the word. You need to make it part of you. You need to let it help you develop. So the word is a very important aspect of serving God. And, you know, I started out many years ago, started trying to read the Bible through every year. And the first year I really set my mind to it, you know what I did? That's not a complicated question, folks. You ought to know what I did. If you set your mind to something, you usually succeed. First time I said I'm going to read the Bible through, I read it through. And a few years later I said, you know what? I'm going to try to do it twice. Well, as soon as I expanded my goal, you know what happened? I didn't just read it twice. I read the Bible twice and then read the New Testament. So I read it 2.5 times or 2 1/3. And then a few years after that, I said, you know what? I'm going to try to read it 4 times. If I can read it 2.5, I can read it 4 times, especially after I'm retired now. And you know what happened? I read it 7 times. And last year I said, you know, if I can read the Bible 7 times and I still had time to goof off a lot, I said, I can do that more than that. So I set my goal. I said, I'm going to try to read it 9 times. And you know what I did? I read it 10 times. Let me tell you something, folks. If you'll set goals in serving God, if you'll set goals in your prayer life, if you say, I'm going to pray an hour a day, or I'm going to pray 3 times a day, you set those kind of goals, or you say, I'm going to read the Bible every year, you not only will accomplish those goals, but you'll suddenly find you are going and expanding beyond those goals. And I'm no better than you. I'm no different than you. I may read a little faster than some of you. I probably read slower than some of you. I'm probably smarter than some of you. I'm probably dumber than some of you. You know, that's just life. That's reality. That's the way it is. But you can do it. You need to digest the Word of God. But let me talk about a little different aspect of the Word of God. And I'll tell you, this is our foundation. This is our cornerstone. This is what we found it all on. Everything else, all the apostles, preachers, evangelists, teachers, visions, dreams, revelations, all those things, they have to center and be based on this right here. They expound this, they explain this, but they don't take away from it. They don't change it. See, this is the foundation. So you need to get this word, you need to eat it, you need to digest it. But we find the Word of God when we just quote scriptures and we refer to scriptures. There's probably, I don't know, I didn't look them all up, but there's probably 20, 30 different words in the Bible that the King James Version people translated word. Numerous words in the Old Testament. Numerous words in the New Testament that are translated word, and they're interchangeable. And that's not strange, because even in the English language, we find a lot of words have multiple meanings, and you have to sort out the context. And English is even weirder, because a lot of words that are the same word are pronounced different, and they're different words. Wind and wind, you know. We got some strange things in English. But the other languages are similar to English. Actually, that's because English was copied off of other languages. And so there are many words in both the Hebrew and the Greek that are translated word in the Bible. One of the most important ones is the Greek word logos. In the beginning was the logos. In the beginning was the word, John 1:1. And the word, or the logos, was with God. And the logos was God. Now, that word logos, you say, well, you know, loco, whatever. What does it mean? Well, it's really just talking about the thought process of God. His thoughts, what he was thinking. In the beginning, God had thoughts. And then he went on in John, he says, and he put those thoughts, he made them flesh, John 1:14. So the Logos became flesh, and we beheld his glory. Now, you can look in the some of the concordances, look at some of the Greek dictionaries, and when you compare Logos to another word that we encounter in the New Testament, the word Rhema, you'll find that a lot of them, when you read them, you'll say, well, they're just the same words. They're just using the same word to say the same thing. They mean exactly the same thing in some of the reference books. But if you really study it out, we find this other word, Rhema, is another very prominent word in the Greek translated into English as word when you read it in the Bible. A classic verse for that is Romans 10:17, where he says, that's John 1:1, where he says, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God, or by the Rhema. And you say, well, why did he choose Rhema here versus Logos over here? Well, the distinct difference in the two is the Rhema is what personalizes or individualizes or makes alive an individual scripture to you. Have you ever read a verse and for some reason it really wasn't a cry verse, but you just read it and you couldn't help but crying while you read that? I've got one passage in the Bible when I read about Joseph. I'm sorry. I cry every time I read the story of Joseph. There's something about it. It touches me. What is that? That's the Rhema. It's working in your life. You need more than just this. You can memorize this book, and you've got the Logos, one aspect of the Logos. Now, Logos also means the open manifestation of the Shekinah glory of God. That's a meaning that it took on in the New Testament. It's a direct reference to Jesus Christ. Vine says it not only means an open manifestation, but he says it is the whole of deity. Now, anybody believes in Trinitarian doctrine, they got a problem with that concept on the Logos. It's the whole of deity. And so the Logos, Jesus took on that manifestation of God. But we can take all of the written word of God and we can memorize it. And there's many people, I've read of people that supposedly had the whole Bible memorized, but they didn't have the truth. You got to have the Rhema working in your life so that it's quickened to you. The Bible says the letter killeth, but the spirit maketh alive. That's what it's talking about. You know, there's one aspect of the scripture that it's just contrary to our nature and it'll cut us all up. But what makes the word real to us? It's the Rhema, letting the Spirit work through us. So that is a very important aspect of the Word of God. We've got to have it. But there's one other aspect of the Word of God. And Rhiannon, you can put that other scripture up there now. This is one that people don't dwell on a whole lot. We got it up there. They said unto Moses, you talk to me. We'll listen to you, Moses. Brother Smith, you preach to us. We're going to hear what you got to say. Brother Smith, you intercede for us. And I hear Brother Smith up here when I get up here to pray in the mornings. He intercedes for a lot of you folks. And be thankful that he does. Pray for us. Preach to us and tell us what God wants us to do, because I want to know what God wants in my life. And that's what these people are telling Moses. But what did they say at the end? But whatever, don't let God talk to me. People are afraid to talk to God. They are. You say, afraid to talk to God? God's a loving God. Why would we be that away? Well, we're human. Because God, when we enter into his presence, that's contrary to our nature. I'm sorry, folks. I've been in the presence of God many times in ways that some of you probably will never be in the presence of God. Some of you have probably been in greater places with God than I have. But let me tell you, when you really enter into those deep places with God, your mortality, your humanness is not comfortable in that. If it is, you hadn't went where I'm talking about, because I am nowhere worthy of being really in that kind of presence of God. And these people were feeling like that, but that's our human nature. We want to go between. And we need a go-between, because a lot of us, we'd never talk to God at all if we didn't have a preacher talking for us. But let me tell you, I believe there's more in the Scripture, if you study it, than saying that the preacher, he's it, he's what's going to save me. The foolishness of preaching, he saved them that believe. So, you know, all I need is a pastor and a preacher, and I don't need to have that personal communion with God. When we have that, it changes us. We don't like to change. I worked in industry for nearly 35 years, and the biggest thing we battled with in managing people was trying to get people to change. Bring out a new idea, and three-fourths of the people immediately, if it's a new idea, they're going to reject it before they ever even look to see what it is. And there may be a little small clause down there that says, I'm going to give you a $50,000 bonus at the end of the year, and they're still going, that's something new, we're not doing it, there's something they're plotting, there's something that they're not telling us, and they'll reject it just because it's change. We don't like to change. And when you enter into the presence of God, you have to change. You have to be changed. And there is another aspect of the Word of God where God actually talks. Some of you have probably experienced it. I would dare say most of you probably haven't. And I'm not saying that to belittle any of you. I'm just saying that that's the way people are. But in Acts 9 and 4, we find that Paul, when he was on the way to persecute more Christians, he was struck to the ground, and he heard something. You know what he heard? He heard a phone. Y'all didn't know that was in the Bible, did you? Heard a phone. We sing that song, Jesus on the Main Line, tell him what you want. See, that's biblical. It's obsolete, but it's biblical. Now it's my version is Jesus on the cell phone, tell him what you want. That's modern. And let me add in one thing that's not part of the message about the Word of God, but I usher a lot and I sit in the back because my wife is sick a lot and we never know when we may have to leave. But folks, I'll just say this as friend to friend. I find it just disgusting when I look around and see people playing games on their cell phone during service. And texting during service. Now, I can understand sometime it'll ring because people forget, and you may forget to turn it off. But, you know, if you got somebody dying in the hospital and you may have to take an emergency, that's all right. Brother Smith will know about that probably because you would have let him know. And the phone rings and you have to get it. But I'm sorry, folks. We're big folks. We don't need to be texting and playing games. And I'm sorry. I've saw it a bunch. Well, too much. Let me put it like that. Not a bunch, but too much. That's a better statement. But Paul was on the road, and he heard a phone. P-H-O-N-E. That's the Greek word for voice. Actually, it's pronounced phoné. He heard it. He heard that voice. And let me tell you, you can get in a position in life in serving God to where you can actually hear from God in that fashion. Brother Smith's been preaching a lot lately about the gifts of the Spirit in operation. We've all got to get in a position where we can hear the voice of God. We need to hear the voice of God. My great-grandfather, Brother Morgan, Brother Carl Webb, he's not here tonight, but it's his great-grandfather too. About 100 years ago, he was a very mean man, very abusive to his family. Knew nothing about Pentecost, out plowing in the field, and the Holy Ghost just suddenly smote him to the ground, and a voice spoke to him and said, this is your last chance, get right or else. He come up off the ground speaking in tongues. And you say, well, that's a long time ago. Well, you know what? That story was part of the roots for the Pinehurst Pentecostal Church, because his daughter and his granddaughter were instrumental in the establishment of this church when Brother Gibson first came here to Orange. So you never know when you hear the voice of God, if you respond properly, what it's going to do to you. It will change you. But you never know when you look back or look forward through time what that thing's going to do. My wife, she was a very devout Baptist young lady whenever we were going together when we first met, and she worked in a bar. Actually, they used a better name in the Navy. They called it the Officers Club, but it was a bar. And she was a waitress. She didn't have the Holy Ghost. I don't even think she knew what the Holy Ghost was at the time. But she's serving these drinks to these officers, and the Holy Ghost spoke to her, just like I'm talking to y'all. He said, "You can't serve drinks and me." And she marched into whoever was in charge, and she said, "I'm out of here. Can't do this job anymore." God will talk to you, folks, and he will change your life. A couple of years after that, we're married, and I prayed back through, and boy, that next week, me and her, we were we were probably on the road to divorce there for a little while. She didn't like me being Pentecostal and her being Baptist, and she went on a three-day fast. Never been on a fast before, but on a Saturday night, April the 7th, 1973, she went in to study her Baptist Sunday school lesson, and I wish I would have kept that book. I gave it to Brother Bryant. I don't know what he ever done with it. I don't know if God miraculously done this or this is just really what them folks put in there without knowing what they done, but she was really, she just didn't believe in tongues because she'd had people teach her that, and she went to read her Baptist Sunday school lesson in her little Baptist quarterly. And it said, tongues are still in the church today. And I was in studying my Bible. She come running in there to where I'm at, and she says, "My Baptist Sunday school lesson says tongues are in the church today." And I'm like, "Well, yeah." And I looked at it, and I read it, and it said it. Now, like I say, I don't know if it said it like that when she first got that book, if God took his little typewriter and changed it, or you know, if it was the only Baptist quarterly in the world that had that in there, I don't know. All I know is we read it, and she said, "I got to go pray." And she went to pray, and you know what happened when she went in to pray?
Amen.
She heard the phone.
Amen.
A voice spoke to her. It said, "Go to church with Dale in the morning." And the next morning, she got the Holy Ghost. Let me tell you, if you will listen to the voice of God, if you will listen to the Word of God, it'll change your life, folks. It'll do things to you that you did not know could be done. It can happen to any of y'all. We're not talking, you know, Nathaniel Urshans and Lee Stone Kings and Jeff Arnolds. No, we're talking about people. God wants to talk to his people. God will talk to his people. He's talked to me many, many, many times. Sometimes when I'm praying, sometimes when I'm not praying. I remember one time God talked to me. I was, me and Sister Diana were working with a bunch of people trying to get them in the church. We'd got some of them baptized, and had one of them had got the Holy Ghost. God had done a bunch of very distinct miracles while we was working with these people where that they saw the miraculous. They knew it was the miraculous. And I was working nights, and I was asleep, and Diana come in and woke me up in the middle of the morning, and she said something. Howard's in the hospital. He was the guy we was working with. Said, "Got kidney stones." And I remember I woke up kind of in that stupor, you know, when you really should still be asleep. And I just questioned the Lord. I said, "Why, Lord? Because we've done all these miracles, and I'm like, now what's he doing in the hospital?" And the Lord, just like I'm standing here talking to you, he spoke to me. He said, "I know what I'm doing." You know, to the point. No elaboration, no details. Shut me up real quick. Actually, I pulled the cover up, rolled over, and went back to sleep and felt very good about it. God will talk to you.
Amen.
We can hear the phone, and it don't have to be the cell phone. You can hear the voice of God. You know, you've got to get yourself in a position, though, to where that God will talk to you. You've got to have that hunger in you. You've got to have that thirst in you that Brother Smith was just talking about. God will do it. And there's none of y'all. And there's probably, I want to ask for a show of hands because I don't want to embarrass those that can't raise them. But there's probably quite a few of you in here, you've heard it at least one time or another. But I don't believe God wants that to be the exception in our church. I believe God wants that to be the norm. We need to be able to hear from God. God will give us direction. I remember I'll tell you one other story one time, and I could tell you, I could stay up here probably for 30 minutes just reciting instances of when God has spoke to me about things. But one other time I was praying, I had a heavy burden for something, and I'd fasted a large amount of time. And I had prayed for hours over this situation. And it had gotten to the point where I was wondering, you know, what the deal is. At some point, you feel like you should have touched God. Or at least I do if I pray for something. You feel a burden there. You reach a point where you feel like, you know, I'm living right. I'm doing the right things. My God's got the right power. He's got all this stuff. I'm following this. And so at some point, I should get the assurance that my prayer has been answered. And so I'm praying, and God, once again, he just spoke to me. He just said, I've heard you. End of conversation. And, you know, I dwelt on that a minute. But, you know, that's the great thing back to the written word of God. See, when you get this thing and you digest it and you put it inside, amen, you make it part of you, then you can take the promises that are in this book, and the rhema can then come on you, amen, and make those things alive and rich in your life. And then 1 John 5:15 came to mind where he said, if he heard you, guess what? You get your petition, whatever you ask him to do. And so when he spoke to me, this came back to my mind, and I said, that's it. The burden lifted. Didn't have to pray about that anymore. I just said, I'll just have to wait on the Lord now. He's done it. Amen. He said he heard me. He said he heard me. I heard that voice. Amen. This said if he heard me, he's going to do what I ask. Amen. End of discussion, folks. So I beseech you tonight. Seek the Lord. Become receptive. Get in a position where God can talk to you. Let God talk to you. God will talk to you. Don't expect God. A lot of people think that the gifts of the Spirit means that God gives you this knowledge and this wisdom so that you can start sending reports to the National Enquirer. It's not where it's at. But God will talk to you. Sometimes God will tell you things about situations. Sometimes there are situations that need to be addressed in some sort of public manner. Most of the times, there are situations where the reason God is telling you is so that you can do what? Pray. God wants us to pray for situations, and God wants us to know how to pray for situations. And guess what? It's hard to know how to pray for a situation if you don't know nothing about what the situation is. But you can pray specific prayers when you know what specific problems are. And when you pray specific prayers, you get specific answers. So I just ask you tonight, just think on the things I said. We serve a real God. He's a miracle-working God. I could probably enumerate as many miracles in my life alone as what you could read about Jesus. Now, not if you enumerated what he said, that he healed all the sick. But just in individual instances, I could probably enumerate as many individual instances where I had miracles as where the Bible talked about Jesus doing miracles. And most of you could probably do the same thing if you think about it, or if you took time to write them down through your life where that you have a record of that. Because he said, greater works shall you do. God's still in the miracle business. He still does miracles. Now, will he do a miracle every day? Probably not. But he still does miracles, and he will still be there, and you can still be a partaker of it. Brother Smith, I'm going to give it to you because I'm running out of wind and things to say. But I'm telling you, let God talk to you. Listen to the phone. Put the cell phone down and listen to the phone of God. Amen. And he will talk, and he will change you.
Thank God. He does it so good.
He's gone. I'd like Stan to come wrap this up. We've asked him to do this on God Talk because I feel like that God has given him something from time to time to make this church better. So that's what we're all about. Thank God. I feel good. I'm excited. I'm being challenged. God bless you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I want to talk to you tonight about one of the most important factors. Well, before I do that, I wanted to say, if you want to be changed, I'm telling you, if you want to just be stirred up, you hadn't been stirred real good, just get one of those Leonard Ravenhill books. I'm telling you, that was one of the first books when I started working here at the church that I read, and it changed my life. I'm telling you, if you read a Leonard Ravenhill book, it will change your life. It'll change your prayer life. It'll change the way you view God. You'll feel about this small when you finish reading his book. And but anyway, that was free. But I want to talk to you tonight about one of the most important factors for success in your life. And if Rhiannon will help me, you'll bear with me. Y'all can just look at this for a few minutes.
Okay, so here's the deal. There's a marshmallow. You can either wait, and I'll bring you back another one, so you can have two, or you can eat it now. So you can eat it now, or you can wait, and I'll bring you back two. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, I'll be back. Okay, so I have one marshmallow for each of you.
Okay.
One. Don't eat it. And here's the deal. You can either eat it now, or you can wait till I get back, and you can have two. Okay?
Okay.
So eat it now or wait till I get back and you can have two. And I'll be back in a little bit.
If we wait, you'll get us two?
Yep, if you wait, you get two. Or you can eat it now, whichever you want. Okay? I'll be back in a little bit.
Sorry. I'm gonna wait. She'll give you two. She still won't give you two because you ate it. So love it. But I didn't eat a single bite of mine. So go show her, okay?
Here it comes.
Mayor.
Oh, what happened?
She ate her.
Oh.
I'm going to go ahead and tell you, don't be eating this marshmallow in church or Sister Midge and Brother Gay and Sister Cindy will tan my hide. So you have to wait till you get outside, and hopefully this lesson will help you wait. So, but I want to talk to you tonight, and believe me, you don't get two, you just get one, period. But I want to talk to you tonight, and basically you're just going to listen in on me teaching myself a lesson, because I need this lesson more than anybody here. But I want to talk to you tonight about delayed gratification. Delayed gratification. What you saw here tonight, this is a recreation of a study that was done in the 70s at Stanford University with 4- and 5-year-olds. And just like in the video, they were each asked to sit in their seat with this one marshmallow for 15 minutes. If they didn't eat the marshmallow, then the person would bring them back two. If they ate the marshmallow, obviously they didn't get anything. 2 out of 3 children ate the marshmallow. Some lasted 5 seconds, some lasted 5 minutes, some lasted 10 minutes, and some made it all the way up to 14 and a half minutes, and they just couldn't take it anymore, they ate the marshmallow. One little girl even went as far as eating only the inside out of the marshmallow so that when the adult came in, they wouldn't notice that she had eaten the marshmallow. Then they went back after 15 years when these kids were 19 and 20 years old, and they interviewed them to see how they were getting along in life. 100% of the children that did not eat the marshmallow were very successful. They had went to college. They were making good grades. They had healthy and happy relationships. They were well-adjusted. They were basically overachievers in whatever field they had chosen of life. And 100% of the kids who had eaten the marshmallow weren't very successful in their lives. They hadn't went to college. They had poor grades when they were in school. They had poor relationship with other people their age. They did not have very well-paying jobs. And basically, they were just underachievers. It had carried on throughout their life, thus confirming what the researchers had already observed in people in human nature as a whole. And that is that the most important factor to success in life is the ability to delay gratification or to have self-discipline. Being successful in this life and with these fleshly bodies that we have to live in is all about learning how to deal with the tendency that we all have. It's not specific to one person. We all have the tendency to want to have instant gratification as opposed to true happiness or long-term fulfillment. It's the age-old battle of sacrificing the good for the great. You know, I think it was a year or two ago where it was from good to great. There's a lot of good things in life, but if you want really, really great things in life, you're going to have to sacrifice. You're going to have to put some things aside that you want to do that you're just not going to be able to do. In life, if you want to lose weight, instant gratification says, eat the pizza and the double chocolate cake right now because I want it. It smells good. I'm going to eat it. But delayed gratification says, eat the salad and the fruit now, and then when you lose 20 pounds and you can get into your old clothes and you feel good about yourself and how you look, then you can have a great self-esteem and you can eat a piece of double chocolate cake every once in a while. The difference in these two things is that after instant gratification, we all can attest that usually you feel worse for having done whatever it was. But after delayed gratification, you continue to feel better and better, not only physically, but mentally. You start feeling, it's like something that just grows. You feel better and better and better about yourself. If you're trying to get into better shape, instant gratification says, well, you know, they say everybody needs a good 8 hours of sleep, so you probably should just sleep in this morning. Don't go jogging. I mean, you need your rest. But delayed gratification says, if you jog now, you'll be so tired tonight that you'll get plenty of sleep. You'll get your 8 hours of sleep. If you want financial security, and Sister Carol talked about this, they had to sacrifice. We had to put some things on hold that we really, really wanted. Instant gratification says, I cannot live without that new washer. I mean, it steams, it cleans, it spot removes, it saves us water. The people at Con says our water bill is going to go down, our electricity bill is going to go down, our gas bill is going to go down. We must have it. But delayed gratification says, wait. Shop around, find the best price, and then you'll have saved enough money to not have to put it on credit. Amen. And the ironic thing with any of these kinds of instant gratification is that even though they bring you short-term pleasure, They really bring you long-term pain. We put on weight. It makes us feel bad. We get out of shape. We start having health problems. We spend too much and become crippled with debt. That's what instant gratification gets all of us. And it's very difficult because every day, as soon as you wake up in the morning, if you turn the radio on, from that moment on, you're bombarded with advertisers. And advertising is all about instant gratification. You must have this product right now. You have to come today. This is the last day we're offering this sale. You got to buy this new car now. These finances, this low finance is not going to be around forever. You got to come today. This is Labor Day. It's the biggest, baddest sale we've ever had. It'll never be, even in eternity, it'll never be this big a sale again. This is the last time we're having this. So advertising makes us need to have things right now. So it's a struggle. It's a battle that we all fight. So I have to come to the realization that my choices today affect my quality of life tomorrow. It's understanding, and to me, this was just a revelation to me. I've never heard this before, but maybe you have, is that there is pleasure in the process. There's pleasure in the process of getting things. I imagine Sister Carol can tell you that it was tough. But there was also a lot of really, really great days when I had paid something off and I just felt so good. There was pleasure in the process that it took to get where I am. And because much of our reason for desiring instant gratification is to avoid pain and to seek pleasure, many times the reason we don't pursue the things in life that we know are best for us is because we associate them with pain. Not eating cake is painful. I mean, I've been on the Atkins diet for a couple months now, and I'm telling you, not eating sweets is painful. Not having bread is painful. Not having milk is painful because I like those things. I enjoy those things. Not buying the new dress or the new gun, that is painful. So I associate with that something that's not fun, so I don't want to do it. I have to realize that life and my relationship with God is meant to be cumulative. It's meant to grow over time. It's not meant to happen right now. It's meant to be something that continually gets bigger and bigger and bigger. I think sometimes we focus so much on living one day at a time that we forget that each day contributes to the day that's coming after it, good or bad. Amen. What I do today is going to contribute to tomorrow's pain or tomorrow's pleasure. What I do today is going to determine whether tomorrow I wake up and I have more pain in my life or I have more pleasure in my life. It's less one day at a time, sweet Jesus, and more it gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. And you know, sometimes when we receive the Holy Ghost, we get that initial high of all the instant things that the Holy Ghost does for us. The peace, the joy, the deliverance, the love. I mean, you know, you just love everybody. Nobody can do any wrong. That happens instantly. Instantly you have a smile on your face. And then there's kind of a vacuum after that, after the first few weeks, because it's meant to be more than just an initial experience. It's meant to be a daily building, a daily growing, a daily accumulating, a daily sweeter and sweeter as the days go by experience. And the more you live for Him, the more you want more of Him. The more you live for God, the more you give to God, the more you sacrifice to God, the more you want God. So much of our spiritual walk is about delayed gratification. You know, if we can deny this flesh down here, then we're going to gain eternal life in heaven. We're going to gain happiness forevermore. No more tears, no more sorrows. Revelations 21 and 2 says, "And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And God shall wipe away all the tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away, and the building of the wall of it was jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. And the foundation of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third a chalcedony, the fourth an emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth sardis, the seventh crystallite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysophorus." I don't even know what that is, so it must be great. It can only exist in heaven, I guess. "The 11th jacinth, the 12th amethyst, and the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was of one pearl, and the street of the city was as pure gold as it were transparent glass. And I saw the temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb were the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof." If we can delay gratification down here, it's going to be well worth it over there. But I'm going to have to put my flesh under subjection, and that's the toughest part. Having a deeper relationship with God is about not giving in to my desire for instant gratification. If I fast and I pray, if I crucify my flesh, I will have power with God. It's a given. I will obtain power and favor with Him. It's making those choices like praying instead of sleeping in, fasting instead of cinnamon rolls. It's making those choices like going to the prayer room instead of socializing. It's choosing to be a praiser instead of a people watcher. It's choosing to be involved in ministry instead of always being ministered to. It's not easy. Sin looks so good. It's so enticing. But if we'll wait, if we'll discipline our flesh, the blessings of God in heaven, I'm telling you, are going to outshine anything that you may gain temporarily down here. Satan is the master counterfeiter. He has a counterfeit appeasement for every desire that your flesh has. But they're all temporary. They don't really satisfy. But God has a lasting, satisfying fulfillment for our desires. But usually, they all involve a commitment. They involve a sacrifice. They involve discipline on my part. And so that's why many times we choose what's easy, because discipline is hard. For our desire to be happy, he said, seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things should be added to you. For our desire not to be in want, my God shall supply all of our needs. For our desire to be fulfilled, in Him we move and live and have our being. So how do you do this? How do you delay gratification? Well, the first thing is that we have to first ask ourselves, will this action, what I'm fixing to do, will it move me toward where I want to be, or is it going to move me away from where I want to be? Amen. You know, if you eat the cake, you're going that way. If you buy the new cell phone because it's the greatest, newest thing, and you don't need a cell phone, you're moving away. Amen. You're moving away from financial security. If you stay home instead of coming to the house of God, you're moving away. But if you eat grilled chicken breast instead of the cake, you're moving towards it. If you decide to use your old flip phone for a few more weeks, you're moving towards financial security. If you decide to be at church on Sunday, Monday, and Wednesday, you're moving towards a greater relationship with God. Next, I need to honestly consider the long-term effects of the decision that I'm about to make. In other words, don't allow yourself to make impulse decisions. I'm terrible about this. I don't ever buy shoes, but I can tell you, if I had to be in a wedding or something and I had to have a pair of brown shoes, I need a pair of brown shoes right now. I took mine to the place to get fixed. I had a hole in the bottom, and they couldn't even fix them. They were so. But I can tell you, until I need that shoe, I'm not going to go buy it. But when I need a shoe, I'm just going to go out and buy a shoe. I'm not going to shop. I'm not going to look for price. I'm just going to find a shoe I like, and I'm going to buy it. And when me and Brother Devin are working, if something breaks, we either try to fix it or we just buy it. I don't shop. I'm impulse like that, and that's not good. That might be why I don't have more money, amen? You know, sleeping in feels good, but how is that going to affect my ability to resist temptation today? If I sleep in instead of go pray, how's that going to affect me today? Am I going to fall into a trap? Am I going to be less sensitive to the Holy Ghost if somebody comes up to me with a need? I need to go pray. I've got a headache, so maybe I shouldn't fast today. Well, how is that going to affect my walk with God and my desire to have spiritual things in my life? I have to realize that I cannot buy the life that I want. You're never going to get rich enough to have the life you want. It don't matter how much money you have, you're not going to be able to buy the house you want, the car you want, because no matter what you get, flesh wants more. Flesh wants something different. I cannot buy the life that I want. I have to make it. I have to create it. Every day I'm creating the life that I desire, but it takes time. It's every day building on the previous day. If I give in today, I'm going to have to start over tomorrow. It's realizing that everything I do today is going to affect tomorrow. When I wake up tomorrow, I'm either going to be closer to what I want to be. You know, I think we all have a desire in our life to be something great. We all know a version of ourselves that is a great person. But we know many times we don't reach that because it just costs too much. But what we have to realize is that every day I can just do a little bit to become that person. I have to come to the realization that there's pleasure in the process, there's joy in the journey, amen, and that there is success through sacrifice.
Praise God. Thank God. Hey, God, what a wonderful night. We have been inspired, and challenged, and blessed, and showed how to do it. Now all we got to do is go do it. Let's all stand. Thank you for being here tonight. God talks is different. Hey, God, we don't normally expect to have altar calls and all of that. But I do think that sometimes things like this have a long-term benefit. You know, it's not instant tonight that you instantly feel it, but you're not going to forget it either. You're going to, it's going to work on you. You're going to realize. And I think there's a lot of us who are saying, yep, okay, I understand. Hey, God, it's not for the moment. It's for the long haul. Hey, God, I learned that a long time ago about prayer. Praise God. You just have to do it. Praise God. If I feel like doing it, I do it. If I don't feel like doing it, I do it. Praise God. And that's what it's all about. Let's just love him. Thank these for sharing so much. God, we thank you for the wonderful things that's been shared with us tonight. Thank you for everything. The prayer, God, that we know that, God, everything starts with prayer.